Hello my dear students and welcome back to Zenith Academy Online. My name is Shagufta Jaipuri and today we are on a much awaited chapter for ICSE class 10, that is metallurgy. And this is part 1 of the chapter metallurgy. We will be completing the chapter in 3 parts. So what is metallurgy? The branch of science and technology concerned with the properties of metal and the production and purification. So when we talk about metals, the properties, how to produce the metals from the ores and how to purify it, the whole method is known as metallurgy. So before studying metallurgy in detail, first let us talk about metals. So a solid material which is typically hard, opaque, shiny, malleable, fusible and ductile, with good electrical and thermal conductivity, denser than the other element substance, example iron, gold, silver, aluminium, and alloys such as steel are also known as metals. So what are metals? From this definition we can tell the properties of metals, that they are hard, they are opaque, that is light cannot pass through them, they are shiny, that is they are lustrous, they are malleable and ductile, that is they can be beaten into thin sheets and elongated, stretched into wires. They have good electrical and thermal conductivity and they are dense. Now, although a few metals are found in free or native state, the majority have to be extracted from their ores. Okay? And this process of extracting the metal from the ore and purifying it is known as metallurgy. Now that we know about metals, let us also talk about what are non-metals. So there are few elements in the periodic table which are non-metals. These are present in the right hand side of the periodic table. Elements that come under non-metals are sulfur, carbon, all the halogens like fluorine, chlorine, bromine, iodine, etc. Phosphorus, hydrogen, oxygen, selenium, nitrogen and all the noble gases or inert gases come under non-metals. In the periodic table, non-metals are located on the left of the halogens and to the right of the metalloids. Okay, so in the extreme, you know, there are inert gases, then there are halogens and then there are non-metals. So the non-metals are on the left of the halogen and on the right of the metalloids. So if we go from here, metalloids, then non-metals, then halogens and then inert gases. Okay. Now, since noble gases and halogens are also non-metals, these elements are often referred to as non-metals as well. Now, metals and non-metals can be differentiated on the basis of their atomic structure. So, when we want to differentiate metal and non-metal, we'll do it on the basis of their atomic structure. Now, there are physical differences as well as chemical differences. So, the physical differences depends on what? They depends on the arrangement of the atoms, how the atoms are arranged. Whereas the chemical differences are dependent on the number of valence electrons and their behavior during chemical reactions. That is, how many valence electrons are there and whether we are able to lose those electrons or gain the electrons or share the electrons. So, the behavior of the valence electrons will determine the chemical difference. So now let us compare metals and non-metals. So first we are looking at the physical differences. So students, always remember in your ICSE board examination, whenever difference between is given, you have to make 3 columns, okay, not 2 columns. One column should be your basis of differentiation, okay, BOD. So this is the basis of comparison, okay, then metals and non-metals. Now children, you must be thinking that, ma'am, we have been doing difference between metals and non-metals from our 6th, 7th grade, okay? But for your 10th grade, you have to learn the exceptions very well, because in board exams, most of the times they ask you the exceptions of difference. So please remember to learn the exceptions very, very well. So first is conducting property. We know metals are good conductors and non-metals are bad conductors, but the difference is, but the exception here is, tungsten and aluminium, they are bad conductors. Whereas in non-metals, the exception are graphite and gas carbon. Both of them are very good conductors. That is why they are used in even making electrodes. Okay? Now the next point is tenacity. So we know metals have high tensile strength, whereas non-metals have low tensile strength. The exceptions are zinc, mercury here. And non-metals, the exception are carbon fiber, which has a very high tensile strength. That is why carbon fibers are used in many of the construction works and in making pipes and optic cables. Now, melting and boiling point, we know metals are good. We know metals have high melting and boiling point, whereas non-metals have low. Please learn the exceptions very well. I'm not repeating the exceptions. The existence in periodic table, we know that metals lie on the left hand side and non-metals lie on the right hand side. Now, bond, metals obviously will form metallic bond and non-metals will form covalent bond. Why they will form covalent bond? Because they are formed by sharing of electrons. Because non-metal, when combined with another non-metal, both of them cannot give electrons. Okay, so they have 4, 5, or 6 electrons in the outermost shell, so they simply share it. Now, state, they are generally solid, exception is mercury and gallium, whereas non-metals can exist in solid, liquid and gas, all the forms. Density, metals are obviously with high density, non-metals with low density, but here the exception are sodium, potassium, calcium. Sodium is so soft that even you can cut it with a knife. And non-metals, the exception are diamond. Diamond is a allotrope of carbon, and we know that diamond is the hardest material on earth. So even though it is formed out of carbon, which is a non-metal, it should have low density, but it has a very high density. Malleability and ductility. So metals are malleable and ductile, exception zinc, mercury, whereas non-metals are non-malleable and ductile in nature, except for carbon fiber, which can be stretched. Now, structure, they are hard, exception same, sodium, potassium, mercury, and even lead. And non-metals are soft, again the exception remains the same, diamond, which is the hardest material. Sonority means gives a note on striking. Whenever you hit it, it gives a sound, okay, a ringing sound. So the metals are sonorous and non-metals are non-sonorous. Sodium and potassium are exception here. Now, luster means shine, okay, so they can be polished. So metals are lustrous, whereas non-metals are non-lustrous, exception graphite and iodine, they are shiny. Brittleness, metals are non-brittle, exception zinc at ordinary temperature, whereas non-metal is brittle, it can be broken into pieces when hit. Now, solubility, they are insoluble in water or solvent. Metals, generally, if you have seen metals, if you try to dissolve it in solvents or water, it remains insoluble. And whenever you try to dissolve in any of the solvents, there has to be a chemical reaction. Whereas in non-metal, they are soluble in water or solvent, they can easily get soluble. And since it is a physical change, they can easily get dissolved in water. Therefore, no occurrence of chemical change or dissolution in liquid. Whereas, normally they are not soluble. That is why whenever you make them react in any of the solvents, they undergo chemical reaction. Whereas here, the solubility is a physical change. So, alloying, they form alloy, and non-metals, they do not form alloys. Now, children, let us talk about the difference between chemical properties of metals and non-metals. I know it's getting a little boring, but then this is the first part. The second part of the chapter metallurgy is very, very interesting. So keep watching till the end and I'm covering all the important points from examination point of view. So let us talk about the chemical difference between metals and non-metals. The first point is number of electrons. We all know that metals have how many electrons in the valence shell? 1, 2, or 3 electrons. And non-metals have 4, 5, 6, or 7 electrons in the valence shell, that is the outermost shell. Now, so the nature is obviously electropositive, because metals can give these electrons, 1, 2, or 3 electrons, very easily and form what? It forms cations. Whereas non-metals are electronegative, okay, because they cannot give electrons, they will take electrons, okay, to complete their octet, therefore they form anion. So since metal are electropositive, they lose electron and form cation, that is positively charged ions. And non-metals, they cannot give electrons, they accept electrons to complete their octet, and therefore they form anion, that is negatively charged ions. So now what happens in electrolysis? Okay, since we know that metals form cations, so cations are positively charged. So where they will move? Cations will move towards cathode, okay, because cathode is negatively charged. So cations are discharged at cathode. Okay, now when they go to cathode, what do they do? Now suppose there's sodium Na, and since it forms a cation, so it is Na plus. Now it goes to cathode. Okay, at cathode it will accept electron, okay, and it will form neutral sodium metal. So they are discharged at cathode, they accept electrons from the cathode and get reduced to form neutral atoms. So this was cation and they are reduced to metal atom, okay, neutral metal atom. So this reaction is known as reduction. Okay, I have already taught you in my previous modules that what is oxidation and reduction. Here it is going from positive to zero. Okay, so there is reduction happening. Now non-metals, what happens? They form anions, we know. So anions, where will they go? They will go at anode. Okay, now let me take the example of this anion chloride. Okay, this is a non-metal. Now this will, what it will do, they donate the electrons to anode and get oxidized to form neutral atoms. Okay, so they will donate the electron and get oxidized to form neutral atoms. Okay, so from negative it has gone to zero, so this is oxidation. Okay, now so reducing oxidizing nature, if we talk about, so what are metals? Metals are reducing agents. So metallic atoms donate electrons, since they can give the electron during chemical reaction, so they are reducing agents. Okay, don't get confused, we just read here that metals get reduced. Okay, but this is happening in electrolysis, when as a cation they are moving towards cathode and at that position they will get reduced. Okay, in electrolysis. But when we talk about any chemical reactions, so here what they are saying, the metallic atoms donate the electrons during chemical reaction. We know that whenever a reaction is happening, metals have how many electrons in the outermost shell? 1, 2, or 3 electrons in the outermost shell. So it will give those electrons to those which are requiring. Okay, so sodium has 1 electron in the outermost shell, it gives to chloride which has 7 electrons in the outermost shell, so the chloride accepts the electron and forms NaCl. Okay, so they are reducing agents because they donate electrons. Okay, any species in a chemical reaction which donates electrons are reducing agents, and any species which accepts electron are oxidizing agents. So metals are reducing agents and non-metals are oxidizing agents. Now if we talk about reaction with acids, so active metals react with dilute acids to yield hydrogen, whereas non-metals do not react with dilute acids to yield hydrogen. Let me give you an example. So if I take sodium, okay, and I react it with dilute HCl, that is hydrochloric acid, this sodium will replace this hydrogen and will form NaCl. Okay, and if I take 2 and 2, it will form twice NaCl and it will give a molecule of hydrogen. So it has given the gas hydrogen, whereas if I take any non-metal here, it will not be able to displace hydrogen, because in the activity series non-metals are below hydrogen. Okay, so if I take any other metal, say K, and react it with any other dilute acid like H2SO4, again it will replace this, okay, and it will form K2SO4 and hydrogen is released. So always remember that active metals react with dilute acids to yield H2, whereas non-metals do not react with dilute acids to yield H2. Next is nature of oxides. We all know that metal form which type of oxide? Basic oxide, and non-metal form acidic oxide. Okay. So metals form basic oxide, but if you remember aluminium, that is also metal, it forms amphoteric oxide. That is, its oxide has acidic as well as basic character. So it forms basic and amphoteric oxides, whereas non-metals form acidic or neutral oxides. The examples you have to learn by heart of basic oxides and amphoteric oxides: K2O, Na2O, calcium oxide, magnesium oxide, iron oxide and copper oxide. Similarly, you should also remember the names of amphoteric oxides. Okay, so aluminium, lead and zinc form amphoteric oxides. That is, they can react with acid as well as base to give you salt and water. Now, non-metals forms acidic or even neutral oxides. So remember the examples of acidic oxides: CO2, SO2, SO3, NO2, P2O5. And neutral oxide, we know water is a neutral oxide. Carbon monoxide, NO, N2O. Okay, these are neutral oxides. Now, nature of chlorides. They form electrovalent chloride, whereas they form covalent chloride. Why they form electrovalent chlorides? What is chloride? This. Okay, this is chloride ion. Okay, so metals can give electrons to this because it has how many electrons? 2, 8, 7 electron in. Okay, this is the electronic arrangement. Okay, so it has 7 electrons in the outermost shell. So metals can give electrons. Okay, also if there are 2 chloride atoms, then metals can give 2 electrons. Okay, and form electrovalent chlorides like NaCl. Now MgCl2. So Mg has 2 electrons in the outermost shell. Chlorine has 1 electron in the outer. Sorry. Chloride has 7 electrons in the outermost shell. Okay. So it will form. See, Mg has 2. So 1 electron it will give to 1. And like this. So it will form MgCl2. So it is forming electrovalent chloride, because what are electrovalent compounds? Which are formed by loss or gain of electrons. So magnesium is losing and chloride is gaining. Whereas in case of covalent chlorides, okay, non-metals cannot give 1, 2 or 3 electrons. Okay, so they will only share. So covalent chlorides are formed by sharing of electrons. So, and they are insoluble in water, whereas these electrovalent chlorides are soluble in water. So example here, you should remember PCl3, PCl5 are examples of covalent chlorides. Moving ahead. Now, we have studied in detail about metals, non-metals and the difference between metals and non-metals. Now, let us also talk about metalloids. A metalloid is an element that has properties that are intermediate, that is, they are between, intermediate between those of metals and non-metals. And metalloids can also be called as semi-metals. Okay, this is another name of metalloids. On the periodic table, the elements which generally border the stair-step line. Once I show you the periodic table, I'll show you where they are. And they are considered to be metalloids. So examples are silicon, boron, arsenic, antimony. So now we know metals, non-metals and metalloids. So this is the periodic table. Here on the, so on the left-hand side, you can see metals. On the right-hand side, you can see non-metals. And this is the staircase where you can see semi-metals or metalloids. So if you see the periodic table very carefully, you will see that majority of the part, major part of the periodic table is covered by metals. Okay. So let us talk about different types of metals that are there in the periodic table. Alkali metals, alkali earth metals, transition metals and inner transition metals. So here are alkali metals. Other than hydrogen, these are alkali earth metals. Okay, so these are alkali metal, alkaline earth metal. Now here is the transition metals. Okay, transition and inner transition. So these are lanthanide and actinide series, which comes after lanthanum and actinum. Okay, so this is also a part of transition elements. These are metalloids. Can you see the staircase here? Okay, so and here you will get non-metals. So these are inert gas. Okay, these are halogens and these are non-metals, and all of them are considered as non-metals. Group number 13 to 16 is post-transition. Okay, alkali metal, alkaline earth metal, transition, inert transition, there are metalloid, these are post-transition, then these are non-metals. So let us talk about alkali metals and alkaline earth metals, which were there on the extreme left. So here they were, these are alkali and these are alkaline earth. So they are from group 1 and group 2. Okay, lithium, sodium, potassium, rubidium, cesium, francium, beryllium, magnesium, calcium, strontium, barium, radium. So these are alkaline metals, these are alkaline earth metals. Now talking about their properties, okay, they are light and soft. Why they are light and soft? The reason is asked. So they have a large atomic size. So if the size is more, obviously the density will be less. If the density will be less, it is light and soft. Now the next is they have a low melting point. Okay. So we know that, see, if it is group 1, it has 1 electron in the outermost shell. Group 2 has 2 electrons in the outermost shell. We have learned all this in periodic table. So 1 or 2 valence electrons which cannot bind the atoms firmly, and the energy binding the atoms is low, and because of this low binding energy in atoms, they have a low melting point. They melt away at a very less temperature. Now they are highly reactive and strongly electropositive, and they are good reducing agents. Now why they are highly reactive? They have 1 or 2 electrons in the outermost shell, so it is easy to give the 1 and 2 electron in the outermost shell. That is why they are highly reactive. The same reason is they are highly electropositive. They give 1 electron and form metal plus 1. They give 2 electrons and form metal 2 plus. They are strong reducing agents. I already told you that in a chemical reaction, whichever species gives the electron are strong reducing agents. Okay. So due to large atomic size, 1 or 2 valence electrons can be easily removed from the outermost shell, and they have a low ionization potential. If you remember in my periodic table lecture, I have told you that what is IP? Okay, ionization potential is the amount of energy required to remove 1 electron from the outermost shell. Okay. Now we are talking about transition elements, that is metals that are present in the middle. Okay, these are transition in the middle. Okay, these ones. Okay. So group 3 to 12, what are their properties? They are heavy metals. Transition metals are heavy metals. They are hard metals. Okay. Why heavy? Because the elements have now small atomic size and hence the density is high. That is why they are heavy. The energy binding the atoms is also high. That is why they are hard metals, and they have high melting point. Okay. Because the energy that is binding the atoms is very high. Now, what is their electropositive nature? They are between strong and weak. We can't say that it is very strong, means highly electropositive, or they are weakly electropositive or electronegative, because they are in between. So, elements are between strongly electropositive group 1 and 2 and weakly electropositive group 13. Okay. So, they are between strong electropositive and weak electropositive. So, they are in between. And their ionization potential increases across the period. That is, when you move across a period, their IP, that is ionization potential, increases. That is, now if you move like this, more energy is required to release the electrons, the outermost electrons. Now if we talk about group 13 to 16, they are termed as post transition elements, and they are the elements on the right. I will tell you which are 13 to 16 again. See here, 13 to 16, these ones, okay, post transition, after the transition. Okay. So what is their property? They are weakly electropositive, I just told you. And what is the reason? The elements have smaller atomic size. We know that when we move like this in a periodic table across, the size goes on decreasing. These elements had bigger size and now the size keeps on decreasing. So they have smaller atomic size, higher ionization potential. Why high ionization potential? If the size is small, okay, the outermost electrons are pulled by the nucleus very strongly. So it is very difficult to remove those outermost electrons. That is why they have a higher ionization potential, because more energy will be required to pull the electron, less tendency to lose 3 valence electrons. And the valence electrons start, as it is group number 13, how many valence electrons will be there? 3. So it is difficult to remove 3 or more than 3 valence electrons. That is why they are weakly electropositive. Now let us talk about alkali metals and alkaline earth metals in detail, that is group 1 and group 2. Okay, so alkali metals, what is their position? So these are the basis of differentiation. Always remember, this is a very important question from part 1 of your metallurgy, the difference between alkali metal and alkaline earth metal, and also the difference between metals and non-metals, along with the exceptions and the reasons. Okay, so first is the position. Alkali metal is group 1, or if we talk about the older version, it is 1A, and alkaline earth metal is group 2. So even if you write group 1 and group 2, that is completely okay. No need to write this older version. Then we know which were the elements of alkali metal. Okay, I'll show you again. So lithium, sodium, potassium, rubidium, cesium and francium were alkali metals. So, and this we make a strawberry. Beryllium, magnesium, calcium, strontium, barium, radium. Okay, so you have to remember the names in order of alkali metal and alkaline earth metal. It is very, very important. Okay, next is electrons. We know, since it is group 1, so 1 valence electron, group 2, 2 valence electrons. Now, occurrence. Now, we know they have 1 electron in the outermost shell, so they are highly reactive, so they will always be formed. So they will always be found in a combined state, because they will not stay in the native state. They want to react very quickly. So highly reactive elements occur in the combined state only, and compounds of sodium and potassium are most abundant because they are highly, highly reactive, and francium occurs in very trace amount. Now talking about alkaline earth metals, they are also reactive. They also occur in combined state. Compounds of magnesium and calcium are most abundant, and radium is a rare element. It is a radioactive element. Now if we talk about nature and bonding, so nature, this is, they are silvery white metals. They are also silvery white metals. They are soft in nature and cut. They are soft in nature and can be cut with a knife, like sodium. Here, they are slightly harder than the alkali metals. Now they possess single valence electron, hence the metallic bonding is not so strong. And they possess 2 valence electron, hence metallic bonding is stronger than alkali. There are 2 electrons which have been lost in forming a chemical bond. Okay. So the bonding is stronger, and here the bonding is slightly weaker, not so strong. Now talking about density, they have low density. Now alkali earth metal also have low density, but when you compare it with alkali metals, then compared to the alkali metal, they are slightly higher, okay, than this. Melting point, this is low, this is slightly higher than alkaline earth metal. So in general, when we talk about the density, melting point and boiling point of these two, they are low in comparison to the whole periodic table. But when we compare these two, this is low and this is slightly higher. Okay. Now flame test, very interesting. You should learn this very properly, understand this very properly. Pay attention. So they give characteristic color to flame. I'll show you this. Okay, so when you take your platinum wire and dip it in any alkali metal or alkaline earth metal, or even if you take the powdered form of it in a spatula and try to place it in the flame, you will see that it imparts different color to the flame. Okay, so these are the real picture. You can see calcium is imparting this bright yellow color, strontium is giving this red color, and barium is giving this apple red. So see here, lithium is giving crimson red color, sodium is giving yellow color, potassium is giving pale violet, rubidium is giving violet, and cesium is giving bluish color. So this is the characteristic property of these alkali metals, and this flame test is used to identify these alkali metals. Okay, so what is the characteristic? They give a characteristic flame color. Okay, so they give a characteristic color to the flame, and they are used to identify these. Sorry. Now coming to alkaline earth metal, magnesium and beryllium do not give characteristic color. So you can see these are alkaline earth metal, and these three are giving the colors. Magnesium and beryllium do not give. So calcium gives this color, strontium gives this brick red color, and barium gives this color. Okay, so these are alkaline metals and these are alkaline earth. Now talking about reactivity, they are highly reactive, most reactive of all the metals. They are less reactive compared to this. Okay, so less reactive, calcium, strontium and barium are more reactive. So you should always remember these examples. Now action of air. Now alkali metal on exposure to moist air tarnish rapidly, except for lithium. You should remember that lithium do not react with moist air and hence kept under kerosene. So that is why if in your labs you must have seen that alkali metals are kept in the bottle containing kerosene, because they are highly reactive, and on exposure to moist air they will tarnish rapidly. Here they will tarnish but at a slow rate, okay, except for beryllium, and forms layer of oxide on the surface. So it forms a layer of oxide on the surface. Barium burst into flames on exposure. So barium is the one will react violently and will burst into flames on exposure to moist air, whereas others will tarnish slowly. Okay, so alkali metal will react with oxygen to form metal oxide. Now how will you decide the formula? This is having a valency of 1, oxygen is having a valency of 2, so 2 here and 1 here, so it will form M2O. Now when it reacts further with water, it will form hydroxide, M and OH. Now OH is also minus 1, M is plus 1, so it will form MOH. So this is very important, the general formula. So metal reacts with oxygen to form metal oxide on reacting it with moist air. So water is there, it will form hydroxide of this formula MOH, and it forms a layer of oxide. So if I want to react these type of metals, now this metal have a valency of 2, oxygen has a valency of 2, so it will form metal oxide of the formula MO. Now let's talk about action of water. So they react with water, liberating hydrogen. Lithium reacts slowly, sodium reacts quietly, potassium, rubidium, cesium reacts vigorously. You should learn all these for your fill in the blanks and one mark questions, okay, for your objective part 1 questions, section A. Now if alkali metals react with water, okay, so when they react with water they should form metal hydroxide. So the formula of metal hydroxide will be this, because this is alkali metals, okay, having valency 1, so MOH, and hydrogen will be released. Just balance it, the two hydrogens here, two here. Now they react with water, liberating hydrogen, same. Beryllium has no action, magnesium reacts with boiling water, calcium, strontium and barium decompose with cold water. So they can react with cold water as well. Here this metal is having a valency of 2, okay, so when this react with water it will form, see, OH has a valency of 1 and M has a valency of 2, so it will form MOH2, okay, and it will liberate hydrogen. This is already balanced. Now let us talk about action of acids. Okay, now they react with acid vigorously and they also react with acid vigorously. We have already studied that active metals react with acids vigorously to give hydrogen, okay, and they displace the hydrogen. So if I take this metal and react with HCl, okay, this will replace this hydrogen, okay, and it will form MCl. Chloride is 1, M is also 1, so MCl will be the formula and hydrogen will be released. Okay. So just balance this, write a 2 here and a 2 here. So this was about alkali metal. If I want to write a reaction for alkaline earth metal, how will I write? So now they also react with acid, displacing hydrogen, but now this metal has a valency of 2. When it reacts with any acid, suppose like this, it has a valency of 2, so it will form MCl2 plus hydrogen will be released. okay, this is 2 chlorine and 2 hydrogen. Okay, this is how it will happen. So this was all about the differentiation between alkali metal and alkaline earth metal. So in this part, we learned what are metals, what are non-metals, what are metalloids, the positions in the periodic table, different types of metals like alkali metal, alkaline earth metal, transition, post-transition, inner transition, and most importantly, the difference between metals and non-metals along with the exceptions, and the difference between alkali metal and alkaline earth metal. The second part of this chapter, metallurgy, will contain the 4 steps that are followed in general metallurgy. In detail, I'll explain you the topic with beautiful illustrations and beautiful diagrams. Okay, and the third part will be the extraction of aluminium from its ore. Okay, so I hope you have understood part 1 of this chapter very well. If you have liked the video, please give it a thumbs up and write in the comment section below. Okay, and do not forget to watch our next video on metallurgy. All the best for your exams and do well.